we now make our return. Yes, another installment of Fully Exposed Podcast. Stephan of Auburn, Maine here, alongside with my co-host. Say hello, co-host, otherwise known as... Just coming along for the ride, Angie. How's it going?
Hello.
Hi there. And they strike like thunderball. Oh my goodness. We just got back from the event here a couple days ago over from Yarmouth. Guilty Pleasures presented by Limitless Wrestling. In our last installment, we talked about how we would break down the card with the most recent of updates. And there was definitely still an air of mystery about what was to go on for the event.
Oh, yeah. Well, they made us wait till the day. And they didn't even tell us before. So it's all right. It's okay.
Well,
it was a bunch of...
It was well worth it. Oh, it was certainly. Nice. I like the surprises. It's definitely nothing like compared to Bitter Taste and End of Beginning Again. Oh, which one was the one where the card was like right to the last minute? You didn't know what was going on. Wasn't that End of Beginning?
Could take some pretense out, especially with the surprises they threw at us.
Well, even surprises are not of who they mentioned who was available for these matchups. As mentioned before, any sort of pair-ups would have been fine. I mean,
should we jump into the first match? Because that was the first-second match interrelated with each other, naturally.
Yes.
And kind of an unexpected mashup of events. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. We got our opening announcements and stuff like that from Richard Palladino. And
oh, yes.
always great to have him aboard. Guy's great, and definitely knows when to be on the mic and when to just hand it over to our talent here.
Talent is sort of a loose word when it comes to our first people here. I think talent is talent. The people who came down and stole the mic from Rich.
This happened on more than one occasion, and I suppose that was just staying more focused towards later on in the evening.
Oh,
but
wow.
No, my goodness, certainly. And this actually does relate to very much so what we're just talking about here at the start of this.
Mm-hmm. With the surprise card.
Yes, because we had discussed a lot of women on the roster between the Bratz, Paris, Von Dale, and Shannon LeVangie. They were end up starting our event by grabbing the mic from poor Rich and talking about their grievances with a Miss Megan Bayne, the Stardom star, and
they literally fought a handicap match against and still couldn't beat.
Even with the advantage, that's right. Megan Bayne just threw them around like sacks of potatoes. It was, yeah. So I know I can understand the Bratz being upset and wanting to say something about it, and certainly seemed like a possible challenge again was going to be issued. But before they could even iterate on that, out comes the Megasis, Megan Bayne.
Oh yes, our Greek Amazon goddess.
She certainly takes to the ring, and takes to the ring. She, at her own pace, mind you, graces us.
With her presence, her entrance is enough to silence the Bratz by itself. She's absolutely majestic coming up and into the ring. A beautiful human being. Absolutely.
But the Bratz definitely took notice to her being favored by the crowd. And then with a few words spoken to Miss Bayne, sure enough, we end up getting our other, debut. Yeah, we end up getting a debut that happened to sneak on in and join in the fray.
Alisha, they were asking for a rematch, and then Shannon's like, oh, my leg in this splint. I walked down here completely fine, walked around this ring completely fine, but my leg's injured. Oh no. So I brought a reinforcement, which turned out to be Alisha Edwards. Not the debut that I was expecting for her.
No, I would have thought there would have been some legitimate type of matchup going on there, really.
Yeah. Well, and she's a big enough star that she could have made an impact on her own, but there she is entering with these two effectively nobodies. I absolutely not convinced that the one with the injured leg was Shannon, because I can't tell the difference between them. Just Paris putting that.
Dale, I know. I think I may have also been confused about that. Bacabella dragging the less framed of the two around like a invisible dog leash.
Oh.
But it's neither here nor there, I suppose, and neither are they.
Yeah.
Well, no, that definitely kind of that emphasizes on the fact, just because, sure enough, we got a 3-on-1 kind of affair going on with Megan Bayne being attacked by the angsty trio. And who comes in to save the day but our other female competitor?
Our homie, the Nomi. Oh.
Gabby Forza definitely helped me a quick work of that, though, for sure. And then we had another upset by the Brats.
Aww.
But issue being, though, that, as we talked about, there was a recent matchup between Gabby Forza and Megan Bayne.
Yep. This is true.
People definitely raved about it, being a fierce competitive match. And Limitless Wrestling, yes, Yarmouth, Maine.
Got to see match number 2 of that. This time, our homie the Nomi taking that away. But it was a good match, and they shook about it at the end. It was
No, and that's what you can emphasize. That's what you can stress about competitive. It was a great competitive contest to show the power, especially with Gabby Forza. Megan Bayne was already as well established, in other territories, per se, and
she's a they're both powerhouses, but Megan Bayne is a known powerhouse.
And her formidability is known, certainly, as Gabby Forza is also making herself, well known as well. Well known. Ew, sorry, pun it now, but it's worth it. That was totally worth it.
Boo.
Totally worth it.
Yeah.
No, she was doing these press slams that I was just like, Megan Bayne has a height as well, so that's a lot of, that's a lot of distribution that you have to put outward with your arms. I can only imagine how tough that was to just lift someone up like that and forcibly
amazing.
Put them down. That's
pretty amazing. They both hit some spears. Mm-hmm. It was great.
Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful match to watch.
Big moves, big hits.
Oh, yeah.
Big slams. I heard someone on the social media talking about a match of the year contender, and I wouldn't disagree to that. It was good. And good job for Gabby Forza and Megan Bayne, to both of them.
Put their 100% into a match with the Brats, and then come back and put 100% into a match with each other.
They mean business. They do. They both mean business. I would love to see where this 1-for-1 goes, and we would be more than happy to have it held back here again. Certainly would.
In all cases, though, they should bless another promotion with their, they should grace them with their presence as well, even though they'd be gracing our eyes with their presence. Yeah.
What a way to start, seriously. What a way to start. And if that wasn't enough, another highly anticipated matchup was coming up next. Fantastic. The Evil Gate, Aaron Rourke, finally gets the technical side of getting his hands on Smoke Show, Ricky Smokes.
Oh.
No, this was fantastic. They both meant to get this match underway. Smokes thank goodness, was on second. And the nice part to add to that was he surprisingly didn't talk our ears off, let alone at all. He was there to wrestle. This was refreshing. This was very refreshing. But it's not like he was being nice about it either, I'll tell you what.
Oh, yeah. No, it was good to see a not 20-minute entrance by our good friend Ricky Smokes.
Correct.
It was great that he did not pollute the air for 5 minutes to say three words, because nobody lets him talk anyway, because everything that he says is hot air.
And gets booed over.
Certainly gets booed over. Oh, yeah. So it was good to see him not talking.
Additionally, though,
I
want to add it to another nice surprise in the match that we didn't have to get run any interference or distractions from Ava Everett, who thankfully was not there.
Oh, yeah.
Or RC Cola.
Hernandez?
No.
Gino Hernandez?
No.
RC Cola Gino Hernandez?
No, that's Ricky Smokes. Ricky Smokes is RC Cola Gino Hernandez.
Is it right? All right.
He's got that smug look about him. It's just, you know. Does Smokes have upward mobility like that? Because if he does, he really should just go with that. He really should. Smokes, if you happen to have that cash, you flaunt it, bro. Flaunt it. We've talked enough about Ricky. Let's go to Aaron, because Aaron was looking fantastic getting in. The crowd was absolutely pumped to have that return from Aaron Rourke. And like I said, looking good physically, too, from the back injuries that he had months ago, I would say he was doing good.
Well, and aside from Ricky Smokes repeatedly attacking his backside.
Yeah, that's the only issue I could only address was we get that this is a very emotionally charged matchup with you gentlemen, but Smokes to go to the lengths to go after Rourke's back like that, I mean, you're only going to infuriate the man more if you do stuff like that. I don't get what your issue is.
This match was an upset for me. I was very, very, very sad that Aaron did not take this match. I was upset.
As we made our predictions, I mean, we knew what was going to go into it and how it was going to lay out, and Rourke went in aggressive. He had the gist of that match.
He did. The pin was upsetting. Ricky Smokes caught a whole bunch of Aaron's britches and took him down, and he just couldn't recover in time for the three count.
I can't wait to see the replay on this. That's yet to be on IWTV, but let me tell you, when it does, I can at least vouch on the side we were at that I swear I saw a shoulder up, and that was away from the ref's perspective. So I'm just saying, Rourke got screwed on this pin.
I agree, but for the most part, surprisingly, Ricky Smokes took this kind of clean.
Yeah.
He kind of took it. He didn't fight dirty. I was expecting a lot more dirty tricks from him than what I got out of him. So
I am glad that there is some partiality with how if the ref doesn't see it, it didn't happen. Like, we're talking about like Mid-South territory talk here with a ref's decision can stand to atypically. That wasn't per se the case though. This evening though, we'll be talking about, well, in a little bit.
That's true. But yeah, I don't,
It's sour grapes. It's what it is. But yeah. Personally, how I feel about it, it's sour grapes. But it's not going to keep Aaron Rourke down, though. I'm sure we'll be seeing him again real soon. And
I hope that he takes Ricky Smokes down next time.
Even if he has to just focus on just averaging himself out with some more W's and show us the potential he has. Being hung up on Smokes, I mean, is one thing, but they'll cross paths again one way or another. That's for sure.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And of what we didn't see of crossing paths, But boy was another crowd favorite, still, though not present during Guilty Pleasures, but was certainly thought of and spoken of. Yeah, definitely Desmond Cole, big
Oh
boof
yeah,
off.
the subject
So all of our next
of
entrants
J.T. Dunn's
of reference.
5-minute dialogue that he could have had in the shower by himself and not involved any of us in
And it still, yes, and it still would have made as much.
impact. It would have had
Exactly.
as much character said in the shower by himself. To himself, I just couldn't. Yeah,
It was more so talking
oh my
about
God, oh my locker room, my locker room, bro, not your locker room, bro.
JT Dunn was certainly trying to establish himself as
The
almost
locker room leader. He is, in his own mind, the head of the locker room.
Dunn, I mean, Dunn has been an asset to Limitless Wrestling pretty much since the beginning. Give credit where credit's due. Yeah, I'm sure. And like I said, I
A
certainly
good
respect the
solid
guy.
mid-card
So
talent.
that's my issue is if
Yeah, good
why.
solid mid-card talent might be an asset to the locker room a little
Well,
bit.
it that respect to want to try to get somebody up like he initially had, and then to be cut off of a title shot, and now he cops an attitude, pretty much is disallowing Cole to be part of Limitless's wrestling events.
I'm sure he
The
has that
crowd,
much sway over it.
no, he certainly did not have a
The
sway over the crowd because the crowd definitely
Well,
let him
and at
know his.
Limitless Wrestling, what the fans think is certainly more important than what JT Dunn thinks about anything whatsoever. He's so fucking full of himself. That's what I want to do. I want to cut him off in the middle of his diatribe and sing Thunderball at him. And that was great.
Well, this certainly made more impact to the crowd than Dunn's little speech about his dictatorship of Limitless and Cole's whereabouts. No, it was great. It was fantastic. I myself couldn't help but get just hyped up over it.
In the spirit of
I was
Thunderball.
certainly in the spirit of Thunderball. 007, baby. Who was your favorite? Who was your favorite 007? Well,
Me,
I mean, they made something like 40 films, so I
I
mean,
d oh
actually, I knew a guy that was a
goodness,
huge 007 head. Seriously, the guy could tell you just about anything, so respect to the guy.
I couldn't tell you the first thing about it. I don't think I've watched an entire James Bond movie to its completion. I have the attention span of a rabbit squirrel, so that's not saying a lot. But pretty much if it's not exciting or a horror movie, I fall asleep about 5 minutes in, and I wake up about 5 minutes before it ends.
Oh, would maybe a Tom Jones question be better for you then? Favorite Tom Jones song?
I've never really got into Tom
If we gotta
Jones.
segue this positively somehow, did you ever do the Carlton?
No.
I have numerous times.
Oh, and J.T. Dunn is so unimpressed. He's singing it himself through the crowd, just yep, singing along. And let me tell you the truth,
I think Beckett's gonna have to learn a thing or two from
I
that.
would go to see him sing karaoke and going past his beautiful, beautiful entrance.
And
What a beautiful man too, just serenading the crowd. But going along to his match, I am so sad about that.
no, let's talk about just how good London was in the ring, you know.
Oh, he was amazing in the ring.
You
He
can
was
see.
wearing a sequined
Well, it's
one
like,
piece,
yeah.
and mixed with Aaron Rourke's glitter,
Well,
every person for the rest of the night was wearing glitter and sequins right after their match. But He did a he made a valiant effort in that ring, and JT Dunn just
The matchup was definitely on its athletic sort, I would say. Yeah, when we're speaking about these underhanded tactics and stuff like that, you know, we can go back actually to the match we were going to be previously mentioning about as we worked our way through the card, but I just couldn't help but highlight the JT Dunn and Paul London stuff right there. Just amazing stuff. But yes, to and subjectively speaking, being a NPC and all, I would like to go back to talking about Crawford versus Aggro. That's right, the Silver Sniper, JT Crawford, looking great coming in, and off that win off of Hammerstone. I mean,
off of Hammerstone,
the crowd was pumped for him. Definitely.
Oh yeah, picking up the sign from the crowd member. Aggro sucks.
Yes, and then this is a majority vibe going on.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Bit populist. I'd say that his opinions reflect most of the crowd.
I, however, would object to those notions myself. However, you know, the impartiality of this is one should be when they're doing these things. I probably, you know, should be less passionate about it, but I do see high hopes for Aggro, and this win over TJ Crawford can definitely emphasize that. Now, how it got there is a matter of different story, with Aggro being accompanied by J-Heru. And J-Heru, I'll say this much about J-Heru. Rue is definitely a guy that is very ring aware. He knows the ring inside and out. And to be, you know, accompanying as his hype man.
Hype man.
Yes, hype man. Well, I mean, we're talking about singles competition after all.
Oh, well, singles competition, huh?
Well, are you saying that with the...
Are
yes,
we...
with and it was more than blatant to see it during the matchup with Rue's interference, with striking and even doing a little rope strangle on Crawford, who every time he was getting into building his momentum, it was just getting taken down.
Oh, I wouldn't call that a singles match. I'd call that a handicap tag team match.
You mean
Rue, like Aiden Agro's tag team partner, Rue? The
no,
new one?
I was gonna say no. Aiden Agro he's in a singles run.
It didn't look like much of a singles match. Almost like can't operate without a tag team partner.
Well, I mean, if anything of what Aggro may have presented to Rue could possibly be, you know, this new sense of ring awareness. I mean, this is to help get Aggro up to VLC. I mean, you understand he needs whatever support he can get. And I know I'm the, you know what I mean? I know I personally am the minority of the fact, but...
Oh, yeah.
If you have a talent like that, why not, you know...
Why not see
where they can go with it?
Doesn't seem like much of a talent if you have to have a tag team partner in a singles match.
Well, I understand. First, we're talking about Aggro being dismissive initially of this, but... I think he's going to be staying here a while. I think, surprisingly, as much as he wants to dismiss Maine, it's still a part of him, and he's going to be staying through up until VLC. I hate to say it. What I may have talked about character aspirations, this could be a thing. So it is an unfortunate loss, though, for Crawford. Crawford is one heck of a competitor, but the odds, I suppose, were against him, considering.
Yeah, considering it was a 2-on-1 match.
But there was one thing that does actually play a little concern if we...
He took the win, and I was disappointed. But all is not lost, because I'm sure Crawford will be back. And I'm sure, whether or not we like it...
Crawford, yes.
Aiden Aggro will be back.
And I'm definitely sure Aggro will be back. I mean,
yeah.
The guy's got his first win. He's seizing opportunity.
I would by definitely... opportunity, you mean Rue.
Well, speaking of opportunities, he certainly tried to make an opportunity after the post-match little exchange of blows. It was more like a DSN 2-on-1 kind of attack on Crawford. And someone wanted to address some stuff that was spoken about him.
Oh, Sir Ace Romero.
Yeah, good old AC baby, yes. And big boy season, and it's springtime, and that certainly means we're approaching not just VLC season, but definitely some big boy season. So, how can you not? I mean, I'll say this much: how can you not enjoy AC's? You know what I mean, like presence and stuff like that. We also got to mention too that these last couple events now we've actually been bringing some people alongside with us, you know, to check out the live event and stuff like that, and they certainly are now. Definitely becoming fans of the grass, so that's great. Dan, Amba, and also accompanied by younger youth demographic spawn ofs and stuff like that. And it was actually the son there mentioning about Ace Romero. He definitely certainly had some positive comments about him.
Oh, he wants a big boy season T-shirt.
Yeah, he certainly is. He certainly was ecstatic to get some merch for sure.
He wants merch next time. He told him he wants merch next time.
And he has a very strong ideology about this man. This man
immovable being... object.
How can anybody beat this guy? I just don't get it. He can just throw these guys around and he's such an intimidating big guy. I mean, how would you want to even dare mess with that? So
yeah. Well, it's Ace, and as I was wanting to say, it's a big boy season, so it's hot big boy summer. That's what it is. We're coming up on hot big boy summer.
So I believe AC definitely, sure enough, will want to definitely get.
He wanted a matchup
in a bad way.
Oh yeah, but Aiden wasn't having it, running out of there like.
Well,
I won't use expletive run. Deleted.
Yeah, well, I'll say he was really wasn't running. He was hanging tight.
And at he least was acknowledging backing what, away. Facing the ring? Backing away facing the ring? No, not running. It's really hard to run backwards.
Well,
super hard to run backwards. I have to, yeah. He was watching his back on the way out of the ring. How about that?
Well, the way the crowd was definitely behind Ace, behind Ace. Yeah, I mean.
Behind Ace, behind TJ Crawford.
I mean,
he
primarily a... They might have to just keep their eyes peeled in general, I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, no, as I said, super hard to run away from the ring when you're walking backwards. So, yeah, maybe not running away from the ring. Maybe not. But still, cautiously and definitely not in the ring anymore. Ace clearing that ring out and demanding a match. He's here. He's ready. So who comes out for him? Mr. Joey Janela.
That's right. So we end up getting this wonderful impromptu match to hopefully, cool down AC's fire there. My goodness. So we got the big boy versus the bad boy. And let's talk about... when we're talking about the opening series of contests there, Gabby Forza and Megan Bayne. We're talking about these, athletes and these displays of power. And this was, again, another testament to show how powerful wrestling as a combative art is.
Yeah, as a combative sport.
It's...
Yeah.
Mighty huge slams. And mind you, like, second row and the impacts is, like, practically knocking you back out of your seat. I mean,
oh yeah,
seriously.
You can feel it coming right
You
at the
feel the
floor.
impact. I mean,
Oh yeah, you can feel it coming right through the floor at us. It was absolutely amazing watching these two guys throw each other around. And Joey Janela, let me be clear, I didn't think he had it in him. I didn't think he had it in him.
No, there was a couple moments where he was certainly trying to, say, I'm gonna get this guy up. I'm gonna get big boy EC up, and you know
And
what?
nope, not
And
so much.
And you know, he got it in him, and the guy, like I said, he's, went through stacks of furniture. I mean, he's been in like fire, barbed wire, rooftop sets. I mean, this guy can endure pain, and much the same when it comes to a good workout too. I mean, this guy also does train, so to lift weight of that caliber and just pick it up and put it down, he ends up getting AC off the turnbuckle end and ends up slamming him down in a power bomb. And it's like, who can do that? Who can do that? It takes. It's a very limited few. It's a very limited few to take on the limitless, heavyweight, seriously.
Yeah. Well, Joey Janela was looking good coming into the ring. He looks really in shape.
Yeah, definitely glad to have him back for sure.
He looks really in shape. He looked like he was ready for a match. And if I may add, all of these guys henceforth are now covered in glitter. Every last one.
Intermission was good, though. We could sit there and talk about diet. I don't think people really want to hear about our diet.
Our diet and exercise routines.
Yeah, no, but you know who seems like he's on a dietary regime of Newport cigarettes and MD 2020s?
That was an excellent segue. You got that.
Oh, that was great.
Celebrate.
It smells.
Hello, Hazard.
Yes, I'm sure if
Connor Murphy.
I'm sure if I got close enough to him, he'd probably smell like Nautica or some shit.
The only thing he's missing is a chin strap beard. Lord. There is nothing sadder that the next saddest thing would be me being also that same age and using the hip terminology that I don't know.
I think we referred Riz one time. So
yeah, we got Riz.
It's okay. We smell.
I know what Riz means, though.
Well, there's the cap thing. I think somebody threw a cap. I got something about pube cap or something. Oh, wow.
I don't even know what that means.
So at first I'm like, no cap. And then I was emphasized thinking, does that mean at no capacity? I think that's what that means. I really do.
I have you couldn't look. I'm learning Russian as a second language. That is my current endeavor in life, is learning Russian.
Well, certainly, I have no idea about like language and geographical location. But how about a guy from parts unknown? How about that? How about the guy that
Oh,
Hazard was up against? How
Sir
about,
Suicide.
yes, the
What a
video, yeah, the video
match.
game character turned life and just, now mind you, y'all have mentioned before. I mean, we gotta talk about the wrestler behind this, this concept of TNAs. And you know what? I freaking search me. I don't know. I mean, yeah, you smart people out there, you can probably figure it out. I mean, it's like the great Where's Waldo search. I'm sure you dig deep enough, you'll probably allude to something. But I don't care who that was, but they were, no, they were good. Good athleticism. And especially because to go up against Hazard, I know he's definitely been dejected by the audience. You know what I mean? These viewers that see his
Lame.
theatrics of gotta catch a body and just
He's so lame.
it's just the thing is just, when one tries too hard, I just don't see Connor Murphy. You know what I mean? Like, the guy lacks common sense half the time too. I mean, remember he tried to eye
All
rake?
right.
He tried to eye rake suicide.
Oh, good. This suicide being like, no eyes, I'm wearing a mask. And oh, useless. He got the win anyway, and it was so disappointing seeing him getting the win. He incurred the wrath of the crowd getting the win. I don't think he used fair tactics, but from our perspective, I could not see what he did at that last moment. Did you see? Because he did something, I'm fairly
Well, it
sure.
certainly was a desperation to try to get as a mask. It wasn't just for that irate, attempt that he was trying, but more so towards
Oh yeah, he's
he
like,
was
take the
trying to,
mask off.
So he might have just kind of, shifted the mask maybe a little bit or something, but something just didn't quite, something certainly didn't
Something
quite
didn't
sit right.
settle right, and I personally didn't see it, and neither did the ref because he counted it. So whatever it was, I think that it caught some of the crowd, but not other parts of the crowd. But I was disappointed. I would normally be like, these are two great competitors, and they had a fantastic match. But in my mind, only one of them was a great competitor, and the other one's a wannabe who was trying to eye rake a guy in a mask.
No, exactly. It's almost like, his abilities are there, but it's like the ego just tries to outshine everything else. And
Yeah, no,
he's,
like
it's like
he
he,
has
it's,
ability, but he'd have to work harder, so he ain't gonna. He's just gonna cheat. He's not gonna work any harder than he has to. Why would he do that?
Well, he already thinks he's the best as is, but there obviously can be room for improvement in anybody. There can be room for improvement,
But he
and
needs a lot of it. Good God.
indeed. Well, I mean, he does make himself known. I mean, he's definitely being, I wouldn't say acknowledged. I mean, witnessed.
This is true. He is being witnessed.
Suicide, you did a fantastic job. Though loss, it was still,
Please
a
come
great
back.
effort. Yeah. Oh, shit. Yeah.
Please
Definitely.
come back.
And Hazard, just don't
Right?
come back.
Yeah.
No.
Just avoid it. Give Limitless a miss.
You know he's gonna come back, though. God.
Yeah, he'll be back.
And somebody who keeps returning and returning and returning as champion.
Are we going there already?
It already is there. What are you talking
No, we
about?
missed
Oh, the tag match.
the
Oh, that's
tag
right.
match. How did you
All
forget
right.
that tag
Hold on. Hold.
match?
Yeah, I know. Oh, and I know why I was probably trying to avoid this, though. I know exactly why. It's because when I had initially mentioned about Miracle Generation, I was along the lines of just thinking them as fledgling competitors. Man, was I ever wrong. It wasn't just the Rochambeau spot at the beginning of the match that definitely got the crowd going. All of the athleticism that these two shared, and that's like the part I can express is share. Because with the Rochambeau thing, I mean, this was them obviously showing that this isn't one guy that's gonna sit there and be your endurance man for the match, and then you have his partner that's willing, to run the latter end of the match. I mean, this isn't one of those situations. These guys are congruent, and they could start off from any situation and end off in any situation. There's a reason why these guys have retained their titles upon dozens of times.
Oh yeah. And this we can take this back to what we were talking about in our last
Oh, and we certainly.
about congruence between tag team partners. And there was nothing like this match to show how congruent and how incongruent the rich and the powerful
I
are.
thought they did
They
fine.
did okay, but when you look at it in comparison. And believe me, the rich and the powerful are definitely not a liked staple in Maine, but they are a staple here.
Oh, certainly.
They are a staple here. I love to see them. They kind of gross me out, but I love to see them. Every single time I've seen them, I've loved doing it.
Well, it's certainly, that you definitely taken to knowledge for sure, just about their tactics and just their presence. And I do mean
Oh yeah,
their physical
presence.
presence. Funny too. And this isn't just one of those situations either. And I'm actually gonna put you over on this one, Ange. I am gonna put you over on this one because it wasn't just a situation with Richard Holliday, in fact, that this isn't just one of those, oh, I happen to be mentioned about it on social media, whatever it is, I don't care, I'm just gonna repost and blah blah blah. No, this is actually, and we do appreciate any of the viewership that's been going on, and I hope what we present is certainly an up to standard to present the product for, yes, what it is. Please take what we have to heart for sure. And apparently that was taken so, because definitely upon making their entrance, the rich and powerful, definitely Holliday definitely made some aforementions, definitely being, oh, that must be the one there that mentioned about me. So
I didn't
it
catch this. You said something to me about this
yeah no it,
very shortly after,
yeah I glance
and
up and all of a sudden
I have to say that
engaging with
I
our
was
people we were
engaging in their
accompanied with.
company, but yep, I am also going deaf. So unless I'm looking you in the face when you're talking to me, I don't hear you. It's it just If you don't say it full and with your chest, I'm not hearing nothing. So he may have. And statue says this is the one that said I looked like a statue,
Something
something like
along those
that.
lines, yeah.
And the precise wording was
Well,
Kasibi,
I know it's hard to
which.
get to exactly what you're saying, considering the crowd was certainly letting them know how they felt. I would say it was,
Oh, it was not a mixed reaction.
no,
It
certainly
was not a
not.
mixed reaction. These
No.
guys got some, they get some crowd discourse. As much, they are the bad guys. They are definitely there and they're going to make a mess. But I love seeing them. I want them here every single time. I do. I want them here every single time. And yes, Richard Holliday, Kasivi.
Well, you also have another Russian word, though, that you
Oh,
did want to refer to. Yes, so
yes.
it's a.
But I also wanted to, before we get to that part, I want to say that Charles Mason did the fish hook in the mouth and then did not lick his hand. And I had braced myself for it. And then it just didn't happen. And let me tell you, it left me unsatisfied. I was unsatisfied at that moment. I got all that wound up that I was going to be grossed out. And let me tell you, the first time he did that, I nearly threw up. And as much as I hate to say it, I missed it. But the Russian word of today is molodets. And molodets is kind of like Russians, congratulations. And that would be congratulations to Miracle Generation for winning that match. But oh my goodness.
I thought you were going to refer to not bad. But
no, oh. No. Not bad. Not bad is niploha.
Well, that's all I was going to say.
No, yeah. Molodets is congratulations.
Yeah, you definitely flipped the script on me on this one.
Niploha means not bad. Which is, for the most part, how Russians describe things that are good. Is meh, niploha, meh. Not a lot of really strong expressions of good things.
The guy at the hand lick thing, and no, it actually got the cut off, so.
Unsatisfactory.
And he's got demeanor about it. I mean, Mason's a...
He's real
mean. He's a
mean.
Force to be reckoned with, that
he's
guy.
He's real mean.
I seriously thought these guys were... And so did the crowd, because we got to a point where it was really building up and building up, where, you know, once Rich and Powerful got their momentum, because Miracle Generation was definitely showing the main crowd why they're champs.
Oh, yeah.
It was ridiculous. And sure enough, you know, we get some change of momentum, and sure enough, you know, we would assume that the pin was to happen with Mason, and a leg was up on the rope.
So he got the pin.
Well, no,
he...
mind you, the ref counted to three, tapped the bell. Now, this is what I was referring to about it. This isn't like Mid-South, where it's a situation where, if the referee, you know, the call is where it stands, there could be no takebacks on this. However, if something is that blatant, especially to other accredited witnesses and or officials of the promotion, I certainly say that, unfortunately for you Rich and Powerful fans, the few and far between, but yes, I would say it's unfortunate, because it certainly seemed like they had that title win.
Yeah,
holding
but he
the belts
had his...
in celebratory fashion.
Yeah.
And then just as soon as that happened, sure enough, those titles got plucked out of their hands.
Well,
then...
Greenleaf both counted out and revoked his count out.
Yep. So we got a restart on that. And it was a rather speedy restart, to be honest. But sure enough, you know, a desperate initial attempt over by Richard Powerful, remember correctly, but to no avail, and that's when Miracle Generation came back with a fury about them. You know, they almost lost their titles. They were in like desperation mode, and sure enough, they sealed the deal and they were able to retain their titles.
Yeah,
it's good on Miracle Generation, and I definitely will apologize to them personally, and we're talking about it was Dustin Walker and I'll just cut the edit on this, and definitely my deepest
Dustin Waller and
Waller.
Kylon King.
Yeah, okay, I'll just edit and cut back, and I'll definitely make my personal apologies for the initial comments towards Miracle Generation, Dustin Waller and Kylon King. Gentlemen, when I definitely was suggesting that you guys are no schlubs, you know, be champions alone, that doesn't even begin to emphasize how talented you both are, and very congruent as a tag team. I see why you guys have held this reign, and I wish you both, you know, continuous good luck with your endeavors, and definitely coming back, you know, third time's the charm with your visits over to Limitless, right? Because this was another second I believe, visit
I'm
over
not
here.
sure. I haven't.
Or at least as a tag team. I'm not sure as individuals if they've made appearances here,
I'm
but.
not 100% sure. They're pretty young, so something tells me that their debut isn't too far in the
No,
past.
either way, it's no flash in the pan. Like I said, this isn't just some,
Oh yeah, no, they were not just flash. They were absolutely formidable wrestlers with a great move set and absolutely strong, enough so to
Their
give,
tandem
yeah.
attacks were really good
Oh
too.
yeah. And Richard Holliday is not no schlub.
No.
He is a big, he's a big man. He's
His
tall.
signature move off of was it the avalanche signature move they did? Like I said, I thought that was it. I thought well, along with that in the pin, that was gonna do it.
He's not just Krasivi, beautiful and muscular. He is a tall, tall man. And
Oh, to be seated where we were and him to be towards our corner, like I
oh
said, and just
yeah. He is a mountain. Absolutely a mountain that they climbed and conquered. And it was, yeah. But I do believe the pin was on Mason, correct?
I believe so.
The pin was on Mason. But Mason is no schlub either. He's a big guy as well. So they took down a mountain of a tag team. And
I mean, what do you think this is going to do, though, for Rich and Powerful? I mean, being undefeated and limitless is one thing, but now that they've just taken their first loss, what is this going to do? Is this going to keep them still focused, more focused, less focused? I mean, this
well,
is.
I hope that they can focus. I as
I'd hate to
much
see them be more aggressive. I'd hate
as
to see them be more
I yeah,
aggressive.
as much well, I love to see them as much as I love to hate them. How about that? I love to hate them, but I think that this will teach them that while they are good and they're both very good individually, they need to work on those moves that make them a congruent tag team. Those moves that are a set and done together and, understanding and anticipating what each other are doing.
I would like to see them attack. I definitely would like to see them, control their corner, control their side of the ring. That could definitely be a definitely an additional thing to work on as well.
Yeah, I think they
They
did a
gotta cut
good
that ring,
job.
as they say, cut the ring in half. They gotta literally keep tags flowing.
Yeah, well, I would like to see them anticipate what each other are doing better. But that I think that they should stay together because, yeah.
Well, I mean, I see it presented as how they are now. I mean, they do have enough trust in each other as individuals, but and I'm not saying that they don't trust themselves as a congruent, but it's more so that maybe they have too much confidence in their own abilities, and they really need to understand that it's the necessity of being a good tag team is what makes a champion.
Yes.
These gentlemen are both very formidable, but they need to be a formidable tag team.
Yeah.
They're not there yet.
Together.
Can I now segue? Now, can I segue into the main event that.
Oh, after we mentioned the fact that Richard Holliday had glitter on his shoulder, along with a sequin, sequin stuck to him after the match.
I just can't get enough about the glitter, huh? It's,
Glitter.
you're adding for insult to injury to Aaron Rourke. He was already defeated by practically the equivalent or the enjoyable equivalent of a glitter bomb that is Ricky Smokes, or was that glitter nail bomb thing? Like he has that much appeal. That's what Ricky Smokes is like. He has that much appeal. And very much the same as in the crowd's eyes, world class Shannon Thomas, our Limitless World
World
Wrestling champion.
champion. World class Shannon Thomas.
Now, there was a lot of build up, and there was actually even some more additional stuff. A little animosity thrown back between manager of Shane Thomas, Sydney Bacabella, towards Alec Price. And then even another video submission. It was either that was one of those backstage segments cut. I ended up not taking a look. I think it was on the day of the event. So I definitely was, getting myself well prepared and stuff like that to travels and meeting up with the rest of the Carapu.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
The crew.
But we got to talk about that match, though. We definitely got to talk about that match.
Oh.
You know, I would have said that this would have been one of those situations where Bacabella would have, just sat back. But, I mean, do you really think the guy's going to, let there be a chance in hell for, his man to potentially lose that competition?
No, but
I mean, I'll just underline that fact outright. I mean, definitely, and this wasn't a blatant like ref distraction or ref pull. It was nothing of the sort. He just helped his man recuperate. He pulled him out to make sure he was doing fine, especially after the blockbuster leg drop thing.
This is This is an audio medium. So you're not getting to see my hard eye rolls going at Stephan here. You guys are not getting to see.
No, this was seriously, this was the least amount, I think, of involvement from Bacabella. And this only I can see as being an encouragement for Shane Thomas to kind of like, and I'm not saying spur Bacabella, but Channing wants to prove himself as champion this next time around, this next title defense. I can't stress enough about Bacabella definitely not being a direct, part of the equation when it comes to the physicality of the matchup. But I'm saying it was a hard-fought match. I'm surprised, honestly, that, when Channing was talking about, getting that receipt on Price, I was expecting along the lines of he was just gonna give a good little a good little smash in the face for his troubles, but oh no, he ends up dropping the prick right on his friggin' head with the avalanche pile driver to secure that win.
We're gonna talk about the direct end of the match and not the fact that Alec definitely beat Shannon Thomas like a redheaded stepchild before Bacabella pulled him out of the ring.
He was what
dominated this match until Sydney Bacabella decided to stick his little grubby hands on the ankles of his precious champion. Cause that's what was happening, is Alec Price was whooping him.
This is the fact that when you sit there,
Channing Thomas should have gone and grabbed his own switch. He's getting whooped mighty hard, and then.
I mean, I'm just trying to talk about more of the technical aspects of the matches. It's sounding more of a passionately talked about thing. I almost feel like this is definitely striking to impartiality here.
Sure. Am I being partial
about it? Yes. Sorry.
Do I sound impartial? No, I'm not impartial.
No,
this.
You are partial. No, that's what I meant.
I'm just trying to keep it fair and balanced, considering that Sydney Bacabella pulled his man out, and that's apparently okay. He was just giving him a rest. Right?
Yeah.
That's what was happening. He wasn't being counted out. There was an almost a 3 count by the ref in that case, right?
It was more the concept like with Channing trying to keep working within the inside of the ring and having Alec Price pretty much running, corner to corner, these little like little 45-degree cutoffs. And I'm sure that's all fine dandy to the modern fan or whatever, his adaptive newer styles, very athletic, very and whatnot. But I mean, we're trying to talk about a wrestling match here, and no, there was certainly the strikes were heavy, and
He wrestles like a much smaller man than he is. Alec Price. He wrestles with those quick maneuvers that you expect out of lucha libre sized wrestlers. But he is a tall, long, strong man. So I can understand how somebody may not expect what Alec Price has to offer.
Oh no, it was pertaining to his agility because of his size. It's actually exactly what I was pertaining to. I'm just saying, you could definitely see a couple things out of Shannon, and it's funny, I emphasize about Germany, and when he was definitely slamming Price around with actually a couple very interesting German suplex variations. Like I said, this was more of two styles, hitting hard against each other, and I mean, it was certainly competitive. And it was certainly, most certainly, you could see, that these guys know each other well, and they were definitely giving it a full effort.
Oh, most certainly. It was definitely a competition. But the advantage in the competition wasn't Channing's superior
I
athleticism.
really don't think though that one assist to exit ring is gonna make the huge difference. I mean, Channing, that nasty. I mean, we're talking about that after the match. Alec Price is, this wasn't one of those situations where you have a wild man beating down, our champion like a dog, and then getting the sneak attack by his now, to this event competitor, at the end there. I just there's a difference between being beaten down and being laid out post-match and being hit primarily with one practically death like the deadly move, I mean, I'm surprised, seriously, that, Price got up when he did. I mean, who credibly is the tougher man? It is Channing Thomas. He is the champion after all. And like I said, if a guy like Price doesn't have a neck to support being dropped like that, then maybe consider, maybe consider a different field. I know I'm really sticking the daggers with you. I understand that you are a big fan, as most people are, but this guy, Channing Thomas, is on this title reign, and
He was
it.
on the floor for the three count, is what he was. He was on the floor on 2.5 with no chance of kicking out before Bacabella took him out of that ring and got ejected from the match for interfering. He was ejected out of the ring, and next time he'll be ejected too. Next time he'll be ejected too. I hope that it's almost a permanent thing because Bacabella interfering in matches. Now that I'm going to go ahead and
Bacabella
say.
is old school. He's got his manager license, and I'm sure that it still does pertain to Maine. As a matter of fact, I know that there is an athletics commission in the state, and given that, he has to have his managerial license. So,
Oh,
well, but that's the
most
thing.
likely has his
So,
managerial
therefore,
license.
he has
You
the
can.
right to escort a wrestler that he is accompanying to. He has that right to do so. You can't
He
just.
does not have the right to pull his man out of the ring. That is how you get ejected from the arena,
Well,
my
I
dear.
know definitely no person in the medical field would have suggested you pull a man after can possibly having a serious injury like that. I mean,
But you're not recommending it for Alec Price
well,
because he couldn't take his hit. But
no, that
Thomas.
was done properly, actually. That was done properly. Definitely the referee helped assess that, to check what was going on, as well as some other officials. They were checking and leaving him be until it was the point where he was comfortable enough and they felt he was comfortable to get up. Bacabella may have been a little reckless, and that's the thing.
Bacabella interfered in a match.
It was a desperate
situation. No, because he could have allowed him to be counted out before he interfered, but he didn't. He didn't because he's interfering in a match. And to be honest, it's the ref's job. It's the ref's job to, in the ring, to evaluate for concussion.
No, I'm still definitely concerned about what happened with Price with that. I'm definitely very concerned about that drop, that, you know, that pile driver was awful.
Yeah, no, it was an awful pile driver, but he only got the pile driver because he was saved by Bacabella. He only got as far as he did because he was saved by Bacabella. Bacabella is the whole reason why Channing's still a champion. This is not his first interference. And some interferences have been with things like brass knuckles. We've seen it. So denying it is not a good, gasoline and fire. Yep, Bacabella has gone to extreme lengths. And at this call against Alec Price, this specific one,
So are you trying to say that pretty much they need to be put to extreme measures to prevent such things?
Oh,
if you want to talk about extremities.
While I concur that opinion that maybe I think that they should chain him to Ace Romero. That's how salty I'm feeling about Bacabella right now.
Well, I mean, if we're talking about an upcoming match possibly with, and that's another thing too. I mean, we've definitely been, got pretty heated well over the discussion towards our partialities. And yes, admittedly so, partialities. I respect our promotion's champion through and through. And that does go, and that's one thing I'll be impartial about, is that if you're a champion for Limitless, you will get my respect because you've earned that shot, much like Channing has, and I just can't really gloss off the top of my head. I mean, right now, he's going to be holding that title. And potentially could be almost on his way to the longest reigning Limitless Wrestling Champion.
I hope, in all very seriousness, that barking up Alec Price's tree was the wrong tree.
You think he's going to want a rematch?
Our friend sort of painted this probably the best way I feel about this. If Alec Price were at a party, I wouldn't talk to him. And that's because Alec Price is intense. He's very intense. So while I think he deserves a rematch, with Bacabella sitting in a cage, a shark cage, just to be honest. But I wouldn't be surprised if Alec Price held a grudge and just showed up for Bacabella every single time.
Well, what about the fact that, you know, he can ask for a match all he wants to, but I mean, this essentially can be, I don't know how a rematch clause works within Limitless. I mean,
whether or not he asked for it.
I think that's at the champion's discretion, I believe, and then follows up by, you know, Randy's call on that one, I believe.
Well, no, and while he may not get another title shot with this, he's unpredictable. And whether or not he gets another title shot, he, considering the nature of this win, and considering that it was pretty much an insult to be beaten by Channing after he had clearly won the match. It was an insult. That's an insult. That I'd be taking that personally if I had won the match just to have Channing yanked out. Yeah, he was yanked out of the ring On the three count, he was yanked out of the ring. He won that match. And Bacabella had to intervene. And then Channing gets the... Yeah. Did he do a good job on that drop? Absolutely. Did Alex take a hit? Did Alex take a hit on that drop? Absolutely. But did he deserve to keep his championship? At this rate, if you have to go that hard to keep your champion, is your champion really a champion?
Nothing to lose when you're champ, I suppose.
Oh, there's a lot to lose.
Or, oh yeah.
There's a whole belt to lose.
Oh yeah, no, that's what it was. Hold on.
Everything to lose? Is that where you're going with it?
Yes, it's...
Okay, that's where I was concerned.
It's fine. I'm not going to bother. I mean, aside from that, I mean, pretty much any additional notes that, you know, we can take away from this. I mean, we pretty much covered through it, so we are running late on that one. Oh, yeah, definitely getting almost into a couple hours now on this one. This is a long one, so... I mean, I know it certainly felt anticlimactic from my co-host end with the main event of kind of the way this went.
I had a kind of, while the matches were really good, it felt sort of anticlimactic. It felt, with the exception of the tag team, it felt like the bad guys took this one. It felt like every person that you just hate or love to hate took their match. And it's not disappointing because we were entertained.
I know. No, that's the thing. I mean, yes. When you're in the moment, there definitely certainly was a lot of excitement going on with the quality of matches and stuff like that, and definitely everyone's drive, you know, for their win. You know, it's the thing though. It's like, you didn't see really a lot of what was going to be coming up. They mentioned of an announcement for next month.
There was no contender announced for the championship.
But we're talking about from a live perspective. So, I mean, this could be different once we end up getting the replay up on IWTV. And maybe we'll get to, you know, be a little more filled in as to what's to come. Because, I mean, we're talking about, you know... when we talk about Outback, you know, people definitely, you know, making their discussions about how they felt about, you know, post match follow up and interview segments that we missed on the live thing. Did we get any sort of matches on card?
We got Ace Romero.
And Hornswoggle too. That's right. There's actually also going to be an announcement for the King of Small Style. Hornswoggle could be making his return. Had a former coworker there who was really, really big into the midget stuff. No, Hornswoggle specifically, but no, there was another one that was also into
I have a whole bunch of friends who don't like midgets at all.
I mean, I know whatever the PC thing is, little persons, yes. But yeah. This one though, the one I'm first pertaining to is really, really a big fan.
Oh.
Really a big fan of those that are small.
And we have Ace Romero v.
Aiden Aggro. Was it definitely booked for the next month, or was it more like
it's proposed
to come?
Yeah, I hope it's to come. Oh. I would like to see an Aiden Aggro trying to chop down the giant redwood that is Ace Romero.
Mm.
We were entertained, yeah, but I can't help but feel sort of sad, especially with Alec Price not taking the championship.
Well, Aaron Borkin, I mean, it leaves a lot
to be desired.
Exactly. And with BLC coming up, I mean, there's certainly a lot we could potentially be looking forward to.
A lot of grudges coming up.
Wow, and I do think that's also part to do with maybe the melancholy I'm feeling as we're ending this off was now that I'm, kind of coming off of it of, the highs of these matchups, yeah, it does certainly leave a lot to be desired, trying to think of other notes that were, oh, I guess something else that may have been of at least personal slight disappointment to myself that I can at least. One of the things that was addressed in the notes that I did not mention about was actually upon a little hey and how's it going with Joey Janela actually upon entering I had actually mentioned about the Invisible Man thing upon talking with Janela and inquiring about that I was actually wrong on both accounts not being like Kevin Bacon like a hollow man an invisible person. And definitely not the emperor with the emperor's new clothes. So this wasn't a tailored outfit, that was presumed naked on a naked person either. So it's not a naked invisible hollow man, and it's not a hollow man with invisible clothes. So no, it's a regular guy just just wearing the like Harry Potter like the cloak of invisibility.
Oh,
So yeah, so that's what it pertains to. So
that's what you were talking to him about.
that yes, well no, also Versace Stoner there. He oh, I'll have to see how that picture turned out. Like I hope you put on the social media of what's it's. So definitely have to check out the picture. So yeah, if you happen to see that, that was I was your cameraman on that one. So there you go. You're welcome. And no, it's a nice guy for sure, definitely. And I appreciate that he gave me the insight on that. So that's right. This is actually a breaking news. This would technically be a breaking news. I don't think anybody has, to
Asked.
my knowledge, nobody to my knowledge has actually found out about exactly what makes this this competitor, the unseen figure in our lives. What exactly is that? Is that about? So that's right. Breaking news right here. The Invisible Man is actually wearing a cloak of invisibility. I think aside from that, we're probably gonna take our next installment coming up, but if we're gonna be watching some stuff. We'll definitely be taking a look at that replays to see what we missed out from Guilty Pleasures of the last Saturday's event there. And also with as we talked about in the last episode, we'll be covering Bloody Media. But until then, I'm Stephan of Auburn, Maine.
I'm Angie, and
And
we're
we're tapping
tapping out.
out. We got
We
one
go.
for one. Yeah!
Woohoo!
The biodome film was so great. Until it became some wrestler's fate. Their work has become a place that's home. It's arrived, the Thunderdome. We as the fan base feel blessed. Adjacent, we sit without the stress. Can hold up a finger made of foam. Now there's fans at the Thunderdome. And anybody can go live, I don't bet. I even saw a foam on a TV set. This way of masking the Ronies. The rest, they tease and tease and tease. But I digress with thank you, fuck you, and shalom. Take a hike. Let the night
yeah.